Hello, everybody, and God bless you. This is James M. Lawrence, and I'm going to have a series of devotional length types of teachings, and this is one of them. I'm going to talk about the use of tongues, which is a spiritual gift of the Holy Spirit, and some people believe it has passed away with the apostolic age. Others do not. In fact, there's a scripture that talks about God pouring his Spirit out on all flesh in the last days, and they will be given supernatural utterance. But in this case, it's talking about prophesying. In fact, Paul himself said of tongues, he said, it's good that you speak in tongues, especially to yourself, because he said, you are glorifying God in this manner. Now, it says that, so people who disagree with that, that's fine, but look it up and try to do what you can to twist it or reverse it or whatever, because people do that a whole lot. And it's very unfortunate. I really wish these types of things did not go on, but they do. There are people who will say it's passed away. It's a gift listed among the gifts of the Spirit. You can read about them in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 on through chapter 14. Read all those chapters, it's actually 12, 13, and 14, in which Paul does talk about, Paul the Apostle, talks about these gifts, and he said, it's good that you speak in tongues, but I would rather that you prophesy, because he said that will edify the church. Of course, there are people today who say, oh, but prophesying and tongues has passed away. So therefore, there's no, no edification of the church other than a preacher preaching with his own voice in the known language of the people who congregate to hear him in church. And you know what? I agree with that. Tongues and interpretation, while the Bible does list that as the gifts of the Spirit, it does say that if there's no interpreter present, which I'm fixing to read the scriptures for this, but I'm setting this up a little bit. So there is an improper use of tongues. If there's not someone there to interpret, because the interpretation is the part that's kind of like a prophesied message, and it edifies the church. Prophecy is not what people think. They always think of foretelling of the future, exact foretelling, not guessing or anything, but by the Holy Spirit doing that, and it always comes to pass. If it's by God's Spirit, it comes to pass. But that's not what it really is. It is words of edification toward either a church body or even an individual. And some people say, brother, that doesn't exist. Did you know that I heard a Baptist minister? Okay, now, Baptist churches don't usually believe in Pentecostal ways. I know two of them who have said that I know for a fact that these do exist today. Okay, I'm sure there are many more out there, but the point being that they do believe in it, and it's not just Pentecostal people who believe in it. It is non-Pentecostal churches too. However, one of these pastors I'm talking about said, and he is on TV, and he has a large church, and he said this. He said, we do believe in tongues, or he said, I do. I believe in the speaking of tongues as a gift of the Holy Spirit, but we are not going to do that here. So he was saying in this church, it's not going to be allowed, because he as the pastor can actually say that. Now, the Bible does say do not forbid to speak in tongues, but that's when a person is speaking to their self. It's, some people call it a prayer language, and other people say that is so false and incorrect. It's not a prayer language, and it doesn't help you in any way. Well, if it's a gift of God and it comes upon you to do it, then I believe it's going to be for your edification, possibly other people's. Now, let me read these scriptures in succession from 1 Corinthians 13 down to the last verse of two verses of 1 Corinthians 14. Okay, now this one in 1 Corinthians 13 says this, Paul speaking himself, and he says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, which is another word for love in action, and I have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. In other words, that's how much a person will get out of it. They'll just hear a noise, okay? No offense, but that's what Paul's saying here. Okay, now down to 1 Corinthians 14:23. It says, if therefore the whole church be come together into one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers into that service. They come into that service. The unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that ye are mad? You know why? They don't understand it. Okay, so therefore, if it's not a church that fully believes in that, but they also know that if a guest comes in, they should remain silent and speak only language that can be understood. And there's going to be visitors in some churches almost every service. Therefore, they need to be careful of what they do in front of them, because they can actually, if people do think you're mad, crazy, holy rollers type things, sometimes they run from church after that. They run from things of God, period. They don't even want to have anything to do with what they call organized religion, you know. So then it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 26 through 28, how is it then, brethren, whenever you come together, each of you has a psalm, has a teaching, has a tongue, has a revelation, has an interpretation? He says, let all things be done for edification. In other words, for the benefit of the listeners, so they can be edified. If anyone speaks in a tongue, let there be two, or at the most three, each in turn, not all at once, but each in turn, and let one interpret. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. Okay, so there is such a thing as speaking tongues when it comes upon you to do so, and you do so to yourself, kind of silently, but you're still speaking with tongues. Okay, now I've done that, and some people say, oh, well, then you're one of the crazy ones. You're one of these idiots that believes that the apostolic age did not end all of these gifts. That's right, I don't. Because there's really not enough that specifically says that. It doesn't. Okay, now some people will say, well, let me show you, and they'll sort of do, like I said, a twisting or a reversal or a adding to or something like that. And sometimes they do it very sincerely, but they're sincerely wrong. Okay, that's all I can say about it. I can't prove any further than that than what the Bible says. And it even says in the last days, God will pour out his spirit and people will prophesy. They'll have supernatural dreams and visions. Now, is that happening today? Yes, among quite a few people it is, but it's not really heard of. It's not really told outwardly to very many people. But yes, it's happening. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 39 through 40. Now, what I've been telling you about is how people can misuse this gift. Okay, now this scripture says, kind of sums up everything Paul has told all the way through, probably from chapter 12 on through to this last two verses of chapter 14. He says, wherefore, brethren, covet to prophesy. In other words, desire to prophesy, and forbid not to speak with tongues. Forbid not to speak with tongues? Oh, yes, but that was only an admonition for those people back then. Okay, I'm not going to go back to that. Just understand, people say things, even though the Bible says to the contrary. It really does. Okay, and forbid not to speak with tongues. Let all things be done decently and in order. So yes, the gift of tongues can be abused, because there are people that want to show their spirituality in front of everybody, so they'll just start blaring out something. But there really needs to be a person who they know has the gift of interpretation in the church service, if it's a Pentecostal church or whatever kind of church. If God is giving them that strong of an urge to speak a tongue and someone can interpret, but if there's no interpreter, let him speak to himself and to God. You see what I'm saying? It says that very clearly, folks, and it says that people can abuse this gift, because many people at once will be just, you know, blaring out their tongues. And he said, let it be done decently and in order, not haphazardly to where people, you know, it's mixed up and it disrupts the church. It really does. It hinders the service meant for hearing the word of God preached. The number one thing that helps you in church is hearing the word of God. Thank you for hearing me. God bless you. I'll talk to you again soon. This is James Lawrence saying goodbye for now.